Welcome to Charis Daily Live Bible Study. Join believers from around the globe to study the Bible with Andrew Womack and instructors from Charis Bible College.
Welcome to Charis Daily Live Bible Study. I'm your host, Tanara Garvin. We're so excited you've joined us this morning for Charis Daily Live Bible Study. I want to let you know that it is daily, meaning the live Bible studies are every Monday and Fridays. Mondays and Fridays at 10 a.m., Wednesdays at 7 a.m., and then Tuesdays and Thursdays at 6 p.m. So please be sure to join us. I also want to let you know that the Daily Live Bible Study is interactive. So we want to invite you to interact with us on whatever platform you're watching us. At the bottom, you should notice an area where you can type in your questions. So as you're listening to today's message, take a minute and write in your questions about the message that you're hearing and the questions you have for us. We want to take some time at the end of the program today to hopefully answer your question. I also want to let you know, if you would like to donate or give to this ministry, you can do that at awmi.net/give. And also, we have a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week prayer ministry. And so you can contact us for prayer at any time at 719-635-1111. Well, I'm excited to introduce to you today our amazing guest speaker who makes me laugh constantly. I definitely enjoy his teachings at Charis as one of our instructors. But we have with us today our Executive Director of Charis Education, Daniel Bennett. Thank you for joining us today, awesome. Daniel.
Well, thank you. That's good to be here. It's been a while. I can't remember the last time I did one of these, but
neither can I.
Completely forgot. Yeah, you've never hosted.
This is my first time hosting you.
Yeah, so this should be fun. I asked for extra grace since I'm probably a little bit rusty, and basically it's been very busy at work, but also we had a baby a few months ago. And so just having three little ones is very different than having two little ones.
Right.
Very different than having one little one. I'm sure if I have four later, then I'll be like, three was so easy. But right now it's kind of just got my hands full. So I've scaled back, but I should be around a bit more often now.
Yay.
So I'm excited about it. The summer's been great. I hope you all have been doing really well. And my topic today is actually by popular request. I got one person asking for this. So a long time ago in a previous message, I made a comment about how someday I might teach on how to turn your weaknesses into strengths. And somebody emailed in or called in and said, you know, where is that teaching? Has Daniel done that yet? And I was like, oh yeah, I should do that one soon. So if you're listening, this one's for you. And honestly, based on the topic like this, I'm sure it's for a lot of you, how to turn weaknesses. Yeah, I know. I just come back and I make fun of you already. I'm sorry. Turning your weaknesses into strengths. To me, this is a very fun topic, but there's a lot of different ways to look at this. Now, I'll get the joking part out of the way, and I'll just go ahead and say, when I joke about a topic like this, how to turn your weaknesses into strengths, and usually I joke about it more just with myself when I daydream about something like this, it's basically... When I joke about it, what I mean is basically using one weakness to pretend it's a strength, or using one weakness to neutralize another weakness. And so what I mean by that is, for example, if you make bad decisions, if you're about to make a major bad decision and you're a procrastinator, that can really help. And that's something I noticed in my own life where it's kind of like, man, I would have made a really dumb decision. Thank God I'm lazy. I didn't do that. Now, obviously, again, this is kind of the goofy side of this. If you're mean, it can really help if you're also lazy, because now you're less mean to fewer people. It's kind of like, yeah, I'm a really mean person, but I just stay on my couch all day. Okay, now you're using one weakness to compensate for another weakness. If you're rude, but you're scared of people, right? Now you're using one weakness to kind of negate another weakness to minimize the damage. Now, obviously, that's not ideal, and that's not what I'm going to be talking about today. But that's kind of where this was birthed, was just kind of an internal joke about, like, you know what, sometimes having a weakness can actually prevent you from causing major harm in your life. Like I say, if you're about to make a really bad decision, you could say, you know, I'll make that decision tomorrow. I'll do that later. And you just keep putting it off. And so there could be fewer negative consequences, but internally you could still be a mess. So even if you're a very mean person and you're lazy, it might not hurt a ton of people. But on the inside, you're still a disaster. So that's not what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about actually how to turn your weaknesses into strengths. So I'm going to start with a quick foundation, and then we'll jump into five tips for how to turn weaknesses into strengths. And I'll kind of look at it from a few different angles, because there's different ways to interpret this. And you can send in questions also. If I don't hit the angle that you're interested in, I'll try to get to some of those at the end. So first of all, I'm not talking about not being as talented as somebody else in some area. That's not a weakness to not have a gift, right? When I watch somebody who's an amazing singer, Tanera's an amazing singer.
Oh, thanks.
When I watch someone who's a great singer, I don't say to myself, it's such a weakness that I can't sing. I do say to myself, I wish I could sing. My wife and I, we're watching like the David musical on DVD.
Oh, it's phenomenal.
It's amazing. If you don't have it, I encourage you to get it. And we watch that and we both sit there and we're like, I wish I could sing. No, that's not a weakness though. That just means that's not a gifting that we have. So if you compare yourself to somebody else, you might convince yourself you have weaknesses when actually you're just comparing yourself and they just happen to have a strength in some area. So that's not what I'm talking about either. I'm really more talking about character flaws, things that you should be strong in, things that don't reflect your true nature, where maybe you're not living up to Christ inside of you, right? And so so my second part of this quick foundation is that God doesn't make mistakes.
Amen.
Right? God didn't make you and say, whoops, I made this one a jerk. You know, and some people always have these excuses of like, you know, I've heard these things of, you know, I'm of this descent. I'm from this nationality. I have red hair, whatever it is. That's why I have a bad temper. And people just kind of excuse it and say, God's word can't work for me because of my dad was like this, my granddad was like this, this is how I am too. And people just kind of dismiss the word of God and say, this is just who I am, it's what I'm like. I have a type A personality, I'm just alpha, whatever it is, that's why I act like this. I'm just shy, I'm just scared, that's just, God didn't make you wrong. Now, he did give you a unique personality, so a perfect version of you does not look like a perfect version of somebody else. You have a unique flavor to you. But God doesn't make mistakes, you are made in God's image.
Amen.
All right, he did not forget to put the fruit of the Spirit in you when you got born again. Mm-hmm. It is there. You know, looking at Galatians 5, starting in verse 22, says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And to go on a little bit further, in verse 24, it says, and those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Right, so when you got born again, the nature of Jesus went on the inside of you. So all these things are inside of you. And if you want to dissect, you know, study love even more, you can go to 1 Corinthians 13. That's describing what's already inside of you. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love doesn't seek its own. All these things. This is who you already are in the Spirit. God didn't mess up. He didn't say, whoops, this one didn't get any self-control. This one didn't get any kindness. This one, they're gruff. That's how I need them. They don't have any gentleness. All of this is inside of you. But what it says is that we've crucified the flesh with its passions and desires, right? So the reason why some of that might not be manifesting from your life would be because, you know, you're not walking in the Spirit, at least in that part of your life. So again, God did not mess up. You have everything that you need. You're amazing. There's amazing things inside of you that are eager to burst out, that are eager to overflow and bless everybody around you, bless God, bless everybody. There's so many amazing things inside of you. And now some of you are hearing me say this and you're like, well, yeah, of course there's amazing things inside of me. But some of you may be hearing this and you've been lied to your whole life and you don't believe there's anything good about you. You don't think that you have anything to offer. You don't think you have any strengths that are hidden inside of you that just need to come out. So again, there's a wide range depending on your background, your childhood, you know, different ways you grew up, right? The school you went to, different things that happened in life, maybe a marriage that you had that was not healthy or something like that. And so, again, there's strengths inside of you already, and that's kind of what I want to hone in on today. So the weakness is when no one sees what's in us because we're living in the flesh. So that's kind of what I mean by weakness. It's an area that you have so much potential, there's so much amazing stuff inside of you, but no one else is seeing it, you're not seeing it, right? Maybe you can't keep a job because you have no self-control. Well, you do have self-control. It's just hidden, it's buried under things. And so, again, God does not mess up, he made you amazing.
Amen.
I have a whole different teaching on you're pretty amazing. And for some reason, I got lots of negative feedback on that one because people really don't like to think highly of themselves. It's really weird.
I'll give you good feedback on that one.
Okay, thanks. So, five ways to turn your weaknesses into strengths. So I'm just gonna have five tips. I don't know, I probably have too much content. So if I talk too fast, you can slow this down later. Okay, so number one is maybe it isn't a weakness. Maybe you've just been believing a lie your whole life. right? So maybe it's not a weakness. Maybe you just need to stop believing a lie. A lot of people believe lies about themselves. Sometimes they sound true because they're partially true, right? Sometimes it's kind of, well, no, that can't be a lie because it bears witness with me. But maybe some it's 10% true and 90% a lie, which ruins the whole thing. So an example with this, and this is actually kind of what sparked some of this message, is when I was a CARES student about 14 or so years ago, one of my classmates had a little girl, and I don't know if she was probably like 4 or 5 or something, precocious little girl, and she'd run around the building every now and then, and everybody loved her. She's super cute. And she would do something funny, and people would say, oh, you're so silly. And she would stop and say, I am not silly. And she'd like put her finger in your face. I am not silly. I'm funny. And at first, people were kind of like, aha, you're, you know, even sillier, right? And she would always insist. She's like, I am not silly. I'm funny. And I thought about that, and I was like, good for you. I'm so glad, because there's nuance to words. Mm-hmm. And I was like, your mom has trained you well. To me, that was really cool because there's such a difference, right? See, silly means, you know, this is goofy, right? It's a waste of time. You should outgrow this. Funny is a good thing, right? So silly kind of has a negative connotation. Funny has a good connotation. Mm. And so sometimes we don't realize that what we're telling people can have some hidden meaning in it, right? If you tell somebody they're silly their whole life while they grow up, at some point they'll realize, wait a minute, silly's not good. No one respects silly. And they might feel ashamed and be like, my goodness, I'm a silly person. I should stop being silly. Mm. But if you tell them that they're funny their whole life, they'll grow up and be like, yeah, that's right. I mean, what I tell my daughter's hilarious. And so I'll say, you are so good at making me laugh. I mean, you are so funny, right? Because again, there's nuance. It's one thing to say, you know, you need to grow up versus you're so good at making people laugh. Because one of them, they'll say, oh, I'm ashamed of who I am. Mm. The other one, they'll say, wow, this is something that I'm good at. I have a gift at making people laugh. Maybe I'll grow in this and I'll get better at it. Amen. So again, words have nuance. And if the people speaking words over you don't understand that, they might be mislabeling you. Mm. You might believe lies about yourself or something is negative when it could have been seen as something positive. Again, it's totally different. If you think, like, what does goofy mean? What does silly mean? Right? You know, you kind of have the spectrum, like goofy and silly usually are sometimes you might mean it in a positive way, but in general, it's not a good character trait. But if you say somebody's funny or you say they're fun, right? You are so fun. It is so much fun to spend time with you. Now that's a very positive thing. And yet they might do the exact same thing. And it grieves me as a parent to see other people talk to their children in a negative way, where it's like, you could call out life in them and say, you're such a fun, loving person. That's amazing. And you build them up. Versus, wow, you're so immature, you need to grow up. And you see, it's kind of like, wow, like that was something beautiful and they just smashed it. Instead of trying to breathe life into that and try to call out what's amazing about it. And so, again, sometimes you might be believing a lie about yourself, maybe a parent, a friend, a sibling, classmates, a teacher, a coach, a spouse, a stranger may have said something about you that made you self-conscious about something that God actually wanted to be amazing about you. Mm. And again, that's the thing, life has nuance. It's kind of like some people have black and white TVs and they look at everything and they just see gray. You might be wearing a red outfit and they just see gray. You wear a blue outfit, they see gray. And they just see life that way and they can't appreciate the nuance and they're like, unless you're this shade of gray, I don't like it. And you're like, well, no, this is green and blue and yellow and all these different colors. And I don't know if you've ever watched a black and white show. I grew up with a black and white TV for years. But if you've ever watched a black and white show and then you watch it in color, like the Andy Griffith Show, right? The first several seasons are black and white and then they switch to color. And when they switch to color, you're like, what? The building's blue? I never would have imagined the building's blue. It's very similar with people, right? Sometimes you can look at somebody, it's somebody who doesn't have wisdom and discernment and understand nuance and see people with God's eyes. It's kind of like they're looking at you through a black and white TV, or maybe you're looking at yourself through a black and white TV. Mm. And then the more your eyes are open to who God is and how he really made you, it's like now you see color and you're like, oh my goodness, I appreciate things at such a deeper level. It's not bad that you're silly. It turns out that you're actually very clever. It turns out, you know, and you start to appreciate things in a different way. So again, this can be put on you by others, but if you internalize it, you might look in the mirror and not like what you see when God looks at you and he loves what he sees. So again, that's the first point, is that maybe it's not a weakness. Maybe you just believe a lie about yourself. And now what I'm not saying is that there's no such thing as weaknesses. One of the problems with the world today is that a lot of people say, there's nothing wrong with me, you need to change. Everybody needs to change, right? It's kind of like people are like, everybody around me is an idiot. You're probably just a jerk. You know, it's probably not all them, because other people can hang out with the exact same people and come away with something totally different. Again, if you think everyone's an idiot because they're not perfect, then you're gonna be frustrated your whole life. And so again, there are weaknesses that we can have that we need to overcome. You know, it's like you hear people say things like, you know, only God can judge me. Or they say things like, you know, if you can't handle me at my worst, you don't deserve me at my best and stuff like that. And it's like the world today, society today is kind of like worship me and all my flaws and this is who I am. Mm-hmm. And they embrace their weaknesses, embrace their flaws and say, if you can't see past that, if you can't appreciate my self-centeredness and all this, then you don't deserve me. That's not what I'm talking about. There are weaknesses. There are things people need to overcome and be set free from. But that does not mean that every single negative thing is true. There are some things about you that somebody never called out, that somebody never pointed out and said, that's actually amazing, right? I love to daydream. And somebody could have easily said, you know, you're just a dreamer, what a waste of time, you'll never amount to anything if you don't stop daydreaming. And I could be like, oh man, daydreaming is a terrible thing. I'm so ashamed that I like to daydream. But see, I see it as a great strength. Yeah. Even if other people might see it as a weakness, but it's a matter of how you use it the right, if you use it the right way. And so that leads to number two. So tip number one was maybe it's not a weakness at all. Maybe it's a strength that somebody mislabeled. Maybe you mislabeled it or somebody else. Number two is maybe you're just misusing a strength. Maybe it's something inside of you that was meant for good, but through lack of knowledge or through deception or through carnal thinking, you've accidentally used it the wrong way. So it could be carnal thinking. It might just be part of growing up, right? When you don't know something. Right? Ignorance is not an insult. Ignorance is just, you know, immaturity is not an insult. It just means you need to grow. It just means you have a void in your life that you need to learn. Part of growing up, right? You have blind spots. So when you're a child, a teenager, even spiritually, when you're growing up, there's certain mistakes you're going to make, and it doesn't mean you're a bad person or you're stupid. It just means that's part of the growing process. There's things you don't know that you will find out later. So, and you've probably heard this before, the devil can't create things. He can just twist things. He can pervert things. So same thing. If you have a major weakness in your life, it most likely is a strength that got corrupted. Mm. So a few examples, right? So going back to the funny example, if you're funny, but you don't know when to turn it off, now you've become irreverent, right? And you don't, you know, now it can be a problem if you never get any work done because you just joke around. You know, you play pranks on people all the time and now no one can get anything done. That's a problem. So it's something that could have been a strength and yet you're using it the wrong way. Mm-hmm. If you are very content, but it gets corrupted to where now you're very lazy, it's kind of like, you know what, I don't need to clean the house because I don't mind it being this messy. You know, I don't mind, you know, being in poverty because I don't mind not working. You know, whatever it may be, it could have been a strength of like, yeah, it's a supernatural gift that you're content. But if you use it to become lazy, that's a problem. Mm-hmm. Stubbornness. This can be amazing. Usually when people think of somebody stubborn, it's that they're stubborn because it's my way or the highway. It has to be the way I want it. I refuse to give in. You know, you're stubborn about your ignorance. I refuse to have anybody convince me I'm wrong. I refuse to not be selfish, things like that. But stubbornness can be great if you're stubborn about the right thing, right? I mean, think about it. If you're stubborn about what the Word says about you, that's powerful, right? If you're stubborn about God's promises in your life, that's really powerful. If you're stubborn about turning the other cheek and forgiving people, right? Stubbornness is basically just conviction. If you have conviction about the right thing, that's amazing. But if you have conviction about the wrong thing, that's a major problem in your life. And so, again, some people just say, I'm stubborn, I need to stop being so stubborn. When in reality, it's no, don't stop being stubborn. Just stop being stubborn about your carnality. Be stubborn about God's Word, about who you are in the Spirit, about who Jesus is inside of you, about what God's done for you. So again, so many strengths. A couple more examples. So let's say you're very charismatic, but you use it to seduce everybody. Right? That's my problem. Just kidding. But you use it to seduce people, you know, and people call you a player or whatever it is, you know, just you're a massive flirt or something, mm-hmm. right? That could be a problem. It does not mean that being charismatic and friendly is bad. Mm-hmm. It just means don't use it to manipulate people. Mm-hmm. Use it to bless people. You can use your friendliness and your ability to make people feel welcome and people wanting to spend time with you. You can use it to bless them instead of just using it to try to get something from them. Mm-hmm. being critical. This is one that I struggled with for a long time. It's very easy to see what's wrong with people. It's very easy to see what's wrong with things. And some may say, I need to stop being so critical, when in reality, it's, no, the good version of that is being insightful. You can notice things, but the question is, what are you going to do with that? It's kind of like the word sophomore. The literal meaning of sophomore is wise fool. Basically, you know enough to hurt people. You know, you don't know enough to be wise with it. You just know enough to cause more problems. And that can happen a lot. Sometimes people, you see this a lot with teenagers who rebel. They start noticing things. Wait a minute, my parents aren't perfect. Wait a minute, there's hypocrisy over there. There's inconsistency over there. And they get frustrated. So they're wise enough to see problems, but not wise enough to know what to do about the problems. And that's the thing, is you can turn around criticalness. So, you know, I used to look around and be like, I can see what's wrong with everything, with everybody. Everybody's wrong. I'm wrong. Everybody's wrong. Everything's a problem. Then you find out, no, this actually can be used for positive things. Instead of being critical, I want to use that to figure out, how can I help? How can I help make things better? Oh, I see a problem here. Instead of tearing things down, I'm going to find ways to build them up. Or you can use it to turn the other direction and say, I notice things. I want to notice what's right about things. Like, that's one of my favorite things to do now, is think about, you know, what's really fun and why is it really fun? What's really good? What's high quality? Who has a spirit of excellence? Why are they so excellent? And instead of being critical, turning it around and saying, I love discovering and analyzing why things work, why things are good, why things are amazing, and figuring out how to make things even better. So, you know, a lot of times your strengths just need to be turned around and refocused, and it can be amazing. So, number one, maybe your weakness isn't a weakness. Maybe you're just believing a lie. Number two, maybe you're just misusing a strength. So now number three is, maybe it is an area where you're truly weak and you can use that as a motivation to grow. Sometimes it's, you know, one of the ways to turn a weakness into a strength is to let it motivate you and say, I'm not naturally good at this, so I want to become good at this. For example, some people are just naturally good at taking tests and learning things. You know, so it's like in high school, maybe you get straight A's without even trying, and then you get to college and you realize, oh, I have no study skills at all. I have no idea how to study because it used to be so easy for me. And I saw this when I was in college, is you see some people who struggle because they're like, I'm used to this being easy and coming naturally, and I get straight A's with zero effort. And then people who are like, oh, I didn't have that experience. I had to study and work really hard to get through high school. But they actually developed the skills and the mindset of, I don't give up. I'm not going to quit. I know how to study. I know how to conquer things that aren't easy. And so then they get to college and they realize, I know how to do this. It's a challenge, but everything's been a challenge, and I'm an overcomer. So I'm going to overcome this. I'm going to learn that. And so again, sometimes people who are naturally good at something, they don't learn how to get better at it. It's like they say, good is the enemy of great. Sometimes if you're good enough, you'll never be motivated to get better. But if you're not any good at it, then you're like, no, I want to grow at this. I want to grow at this. When I was in high school, I had a math teacher who was brilliant. He was the worst math teacher in the world because he would just look at us. We'd say, I don't understand. He'd be like, what's not to understand? This is so easy. He'd be like, you haven't taught us anything. You just told us, and then you said, it's easy, right? And we're like, no, it's not. I'm glad you're brilliant, but you're not helping us. But somebody who's not as brilliant might be a much better teacher. Because they might have more empathy. I know what it's like to not understand this. Let me explain it. I understand what it's like to be confused. Let me have more patience with you. Right? So again, sometimes a weakness, if it motivates you to learn and be intentional, can really, really help. Again, there's so many areas this could be. If you're not naturally kind, then you can be more intentional about it and say, you know what? It doesn't come naturally to me. So I'm going to study it. I'm going to think, how can I bless people? How can I be more kind to people? How can I be more generous to people? You know, if you're not naturally creative, you might say, how can I be more creative? How can I, you know, be intentional about growing in this area? If you don't have strong work ethic, you can say, you know what, I don't like to work, but I want to grow in that area. So how can I learn how to embrace it? How can I change my mindset? How can I grow in my skills and my abilities and things like that? So again, sometimes it's a blessing because it motivates you to learn. Again, you have a lot of people who are naturals who just kind of plateau, and that's all they'll ever be, is what they were gifted with. But if you have a gift and work ethic, you can take it so much farther. Number four, so let's move on. I want to leave some time for Q&A. Maybe it's a blessing in disguise that you're weak in that area, and it'll be easier to trust God. So sometimes you think you should be strong in something when in reality you shouldn't, right? it's when I'm weak, then I'm strong, like what Paul said. One example is, Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6, that's pretty well known. But trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him and He shall direct your paths. See, it's much easier to lean on God if you know that you're not wise in the natural anyway. Mm-hmm. If somebody's very, very smart in the natural, they'll have a harder time trusting God because they're like, but I'm so good at this. Mm-hmm. I don't want to let go. I don't want to trust God because I'm so good at running my own life. But if you realize, no, I'm not good at this. My life's a mess without Him. It's going to be easier for you to trust Him where you actually skip that. You know, one example of this is self-esteem. Mm-hmm. Some people have a lot of natural self-esteem and a lot of people don't. And people who naturally have that are going to have a much harder time saying, God, I give you all of me. I trust you. I only care about what you think of me. But people who don't have self-esteem, you can skip it. See, some people with low self-esteem, they read self-help books and all these things to try to learn how to value themselves more, how to have more confidence, all these things. You can actually skip all that and say, I don't want to have value because I'm really good at seeing value in myself, in my own strength. I want to see myself the way God sees me. Right? I don't want to have confidence because of who I am. I want to have confidence because of who He is. And so in some ways, it might actually be easier for you to trust God in some area mm-hmm. than somebody who's good enough and never felt the need to, I don't need God, I'm fine. Right? If you're naturally wealthy, if you inherited a bunch of money, you grew up wealthy, you got a good job and just have that lifestyle, it may be harder for you to unlearn some of that and say, it's not about me, I need to trust God. But if that's not an area of strength in your life, then it's more obvious of like, yeah, I've got nothing going for me. I need to trust God. It might actually be much easier because you have less you need to unlearn. Mm-hmm. That's why it says, not many noble, not many wise come to the kingdom, right? God calls people, but people who think they're good enough without Him are less likely to run to Him. Mm. Luke 7 verse 47, this is a much longer story, but this is when the prostitute came and worshiped Jesus and washed His feet and all that, and the Pharisee was offended. And so Luke 7:47 says, Jesus says, therefore I say to her, say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. Mm-hmm. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. Right? See, everybody who comes to Jesus is forgiven the same amount. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of some people know it more than others. Right? I used to read this scripture and be discouraged because I was like, I haven't lived decades in sin to where now I can love Jesus as much as she did. But God's like, no, she just realized how much she was forgiven for, and the Pharisee didn't realize how much he needed to be forgiven for. But it's more about that realization. Mm-hmm. See, for her, it was easy to love Jesus with all her heart because she knew, I need you. I'm a mess. I deserve hell. My life's a disaster, and you chose me and you love me anyway. I'm going to worship you and love you with all my heart. And the Pharisee was kind of like, you know, come on in, Jesus, I'll have a meal with you. He didn't realize it. So again, sometimes a weakness can actually prompt you to be even stronger in an area than somebody who wasn't weak in that area. Mm. And so number five, the last tip that I'll cover today is sometimes you just have to jump out of the boat and learn how to walk on water with Jesus. So sometimes you have a weakness in an area, and if you just say, Jesus, perfect me, and then I'll walk with you, you know, it doesn't work that way. Right? I mean, think about Peter. He jumped out of the boat and walked on water and he sank. He messed up. But at the end of the day, who learned more, Peter or the guys who stayed in the boat? See, sometimes you just got to say, you know what? I'm going to walk with Jesus. And if I mess up, that's okay because He's right there with me and He'll pick me back up. So again, with any area where you're weak, just say, instead of waiting for Him to perfect me and then I'll walk with Him, I'm going to walk with Him and that's how He'll perfect me. So instead of saying, I want to have more faith, so I'm going to stay here until I have more faith, and then I'll go out and do great things with Jesus. That's the slowest way to learn. When I learned when I was studying language, I was studying Korean in the military, you know, they'd always say perfectionists have the hardest time learning languages because they don't want to say anything if they're wrong. But then you have people who just don't care, and I'll mess up all the time. They learn really fast. It's like children. Children learn very easily because they mess up all the time and don't care. They just get better and better and better. So same thing. If you have a temper, don't say, I'm not going to hang out with people until I've mastered my temper. No, just walk with Jesus. Mm-hmm. The moment you notice, like, you know what, I messed up. Yeah. As soon as you notice, just repent. Lord, that's not who I am. Set me free from that. Thank you. That's not who I am. I'm just going to repent. I'll apologize to anybody I snapped at, anything like that. You know, and just, you can get quicker and quicker at it where it's like, man, you know, maybe you have road rage when you drive and you yell at people a lot. Just start, you know, as soon as you notice yourself doing that, be like, that's not who I am. That's not what's inside of me. I repent. I'm not going to be like that. That's not what I want to flow from me. I want to flow from my spirit, not from my flesh, no matter how stupid they are, no matter how much they almost killed everybody, you know. And so again, sometimes you need to jump out of the boat and say, I'm going to walk this out with you, and I'm going to mess up, and that's okay. Jesus is an amazing coach. He's you know, the Holy Spirit's our teacher. He's patient with us. He corrects us. He teaches us. Mm-hmm. He guides us. So don't sit around doing nothing with your life and say, I'm not perfect yet, so God can't use me. Just walk with God. Talk with God. Mm-hmm. When you fall down, do what Peter did and say, Lord, save me. Help me. Mm-hmm. So to me, that's one of the best ways to turn your weakness into a strength. Again, Peter, he messed up big time. He'd stick his foot in his mouth all the time. And yet by messing up, he got more coaching. And that's really what you want. I mean, I'd rather mess up and get coached than never realize that I needed Jesus to tell me something. And so again, sometimes just go for it and just be aware of it and just say, Lord, this is an area I want to grow in, and I trust that you'll correct me along the way. You'll course correct me. So one last example with that before I wrap up. Imagine that you're hiking with the best surgeon in the world, and you fall down and you cut your leg, and you say, help. And the best surgeon in the world says, oh, well, no, I'm a perfectionist. Like, I don't have my tools. I don't have, you know, we're not in the operating room. Mm-hmm. I don't have my assistant with me. I don't have the nurses. I don't have enough lighting. Like, no, I refuse to do subpar work. I won't put my name on that. I can't just, and you're like, come on, just help me out, right? Sometimes we're such perfectionists where we say, as long as I'm weak in this area, I'm not going to help anybody. I'm not going to live. I'm not going to have relationships. I'm not going to try. I won't get a job until I have strong work ethic. Now get a job and learn how to have strong work ethic on the job. Things like that. And so, again, don't sit around saying no to Jesus when he's like, no, just seriously, I can use you now. Mm-hmm. And as you mess up, we'll talk about it. We'll work through it. So again, to wrap up, you know, the first one is maybe it's not a weakness at all. Maybe you're just believing lies. And that's a big one. When you look in the mirror, if you don't like what you see, you're not looking through Jesus' eyes. And you need to talk with him about that. You need to have him set you free from those lies. Number two, maybe you're just misusing a strength. Maybe it's something that was meant for one thing and you're using it for the flesh and you just need to use it for the spirit. Number three was maybe it's an area where you are truly weak and you can use it as motivation to grow. You say, you know what, if I were naturally good at this, I never would have thought about it, but I'm so motivated. I want to be amazing at this. And you may not have ever thought that if you hadn't been weak in that area. Number four, maybe it's a blessing in disguise because now you realize that you need Jesus to overcome this and you can't lean on your own strength. And number five is sometimes you just have to jump out of the boat and be willing to sink, knowing that he's going to lift you up each time you do if you call out to him. So again, have confidence that God made you amazing. Have confidence he didn't mess up, that there are good things inside of you. Amen. And that it's just a matter of God did not create you with any weaknesses. So any weakness did not come from him. You need to have that confidence going into this and realize if God goes digging through my heart, he's not going to uncover that I'm pathetic. That's not true. You aren't. So don't be afraid of what God's trying to show you in your own life, because he's trying to show you amazing, wonderful things he put in there and the ability to use it well in this world to bless more and more people. So that's what I had to share with y'all today. I hope it's a blessing, and I look forward to your questions. And
Amen. Yeah. I know, it was such a beautiful teaching too. And I love especially that last point where you just said, sometimes you've just got to jump out of the boat and walk with Jesus, that he is an amazing coach. That was really good. Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. I know we've got some great questions coming in. And so, Daniel, if you're ready,
sure.
I've got some questions for you.
All my answers will be five words or less.
That's perfect. So our first question comes from Wakuna on YouTube. And they ask, how do you turn being an introvert into a strength?
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Actually, that was an example I forgot to use. Being an introvert's amazing. I'm an introvert. You'll actually find most teachers are introverts. Being an introvert is not the same thing as fear of people. Mm. So you can be an introvert and love people. An introvert just means that you're energized by being by yourself. An extrovert is somebody who's energized by being around people. Mm-hmm. And so that has nothing to do with whether you like them or not. And I mentioned this in Relationship University. But you can be an introvert who likes people or doesn't like people. You can be an extrovert who likes people or doesn't like people. And they're the worst. If you're an extrovert where you need to be around people and yet you don't like them, you can probably think of those people, right? It's like, why are you always here? You know, you hate all of us, you're a jerk to everybody, but you just won't go away, right? It's because the introverts who don't like people, you don't know about them because they're avoiding you. It's the extroverts who don't like people that are really annoying. But introverts can absolutely, like, I love people, but I'm not energized by people. I have to recharge on my own. And so introvert can be a huge strength because you can just harness it. First of all, don't be ashamed of it. If you're like, yeah, I enjoy people, but I need time by myself, that's great. You can spend that time. The reason I mentioned a lot of teachers are introverts, it's because they enjoy being by themselves, spending time with God, studying the Word, learning things. And then they go in front of people and share what they got. If you always love to be in front of people or be in groups and things like that, then you might not be as inclined to spend time on your own studying and learning things. Mm. And so a lot of times, I'm not saying that extroverts can't be like that, just saying a lot of times people, the way to harness this and make it a strength is just to take advantage of it. Yeah. How can I use my time alone to bless people when I am with them? How can I use my time alone to change the kingdom? It's, you know, I just love spending time studying, learning. I love time working on projects, right? Sometimes, you know, some personalities can handle, like I can sit in front of a computer and edit something or write something for hours and hours and hours. An extrovert may not be able to do that. They're sitting there and they're kind of like, you know, when can I take a break? How can I go hang out with people? And extroverts have their own set of strengths, right? Where it's like, yeah, you love being around people. You can just encourage people and chat with people all day long. That's great. So I'd say don't be ashamed about it and just say, how can I use this to bless my family, to bless the kingdom and all that? Like, part of how I knew my wife was the one I wanted to marry is that we're both introverts in that sense. And I was like, when I spend time, you know, this is a weird compliment, but introverts might get it, where you tell somebody, when I'm with you, I feel like I'm alone. And that can be a great compliment between introverts, right? It's like, you don't drain me. When I'm with you, I feel just as relaxed and energized as if I were spending time by myself. And so you can find different ways to harness that. Again, I don't know your specific strengths of like your giftings and talents, but being an introvert can definitely be a blessing, same as being an extrovert. Sometimes, like I hire people, sometimes like I need an extrovert for that job, I need an introvert for that job. I need someone who's gonna enjoy being in a cubicle on a computer, and I need someone who's gonna enjoy being walking the hallways and things like that. If you get someone in the wrong position, they're always gonna resist what you need from them. And so there's definitely a use for it. Don't think that it's a flaw. God didn't mess up. I love to go on walks and just talk and pray with God and all these wonderful things. And I can just spend hours, I can spend day, weeks by myself and not even notice and just love it. Yeah. So there's definitely strength in that. I'd encourage you to spend time with God and say, this part of me, how can I enjoy this more? And if you're scared of people, that's a different story. So if you feel uncomfortable with people, then just say, God, how do I see them through your eyes? How can I realize that I can be a blessing to them? And how can I grow in being friendly and being a better listener, a better communicator, a better conversationalist, things like that? And realizing like, I am who you say I am, so I don't need their approval. And once you don't need someone's approval, it's easier to be kind to them. Because now I'm just focused on blessing you and enjoying you, and I'm not trying to take anything from you. Mm-hmm. I'm not expecting you to validate me. And so now I'm not scared of you. So now I don't hang out with you and feel pressure to have you accept me, things like that. So again, I hope I didn't misinterpret what you mean by introvert, but hopefully that helps. Hopefully I hit enough angles for that to help.
No, that was very thorough. It was very good. So our next question, it comes from Samaya on YouTube. And she asks, in 2 Corinthians, it says, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. Can it be that God uses some of our weaknesses to demonstrate greatness in his power?
I guess my thorough answer would be maybe. It depends what you mean by that. So again, like what Paul's saying right there, it's, you know, God can use our weaknesses as strengths because, like, and that's kind of relating to, I think, point number 4, or maybe 3, which is, I think, yeah, 4. Because I realize that in my own strength, I have no strength, I have weakness. Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to rely on Jesus' strength. That's great. But it depends what you mean by weakness. If you say, well, I'm really sick in this area, and so God's using that as a strong testimony. He wants me to be sick so that I can minister to sick people. He wants me to have a broken marriage so I can minister to people with broken marriages. You know, it's not that God can take a negative situation and use it, but it doesn't mean that God caused that. Mm. And that's what God wanted for you, where God's putting hardship on you or making it something, a struggle for you just to bless other people. Because it's a great testimony to say, yeah, it wasn't difficult, and God's grace is enough. Because really, God's grace should, you know, if we truly understand it, we realize overcoming should be easy. It shouldn't be hard. So if your testimony is, look at how I endured hardship and how difficult this was, and God still comforted me, that's not actually the best kind of testimony, because the true kind of testimony is, because of God's grace, he did this for me. He made this easy for me. So I'd say, I think the way you mean it, I would say yes. But just to make sure, you know, God can absolutely use an area where you're not strong. For example, Paul was a Jew, and God sent him to the Gentiles, but he was very educated, but he went to a people who didn't respect his education. Mm-hmm. But then Peter was a fisherman, and he was sent to the Jews. So God, in that sense, God did send people to a place to, it showed his strength even more, because he sent Peter to the people who normally wouldn't respond to him, because they could easily dismiss him and say, you're an uneducated fisherman, who are you? And then the Paul, who could have said, listen to me, I'm elite among your social circles, God sent him to people who didn't care about any of that. So in that sense, God can use that, where maybe it can be a lot of different areas. Like some people say, because I used to be an alcoholic, now I'm supposed to minister to alcoholics, that can work. But maybe it's, I've never tasted alcohol in my whole life, and God's going to use me to minister at alcoholics, because it's his strength, not ours.
Right.
So I'd say yes and no, depending on what you mean.
Yeah.
I hope that helps.
It's true, because it is a broad category. It could encompass a lot, but I think that was very well stated, Daniel.
Yeah, well,
thanks. So thank
but
you.
Ultimately, all of us, we're all earthen vessels, right? And so all of us, if we let God's power flow through us, that is our weakness showing his strength. Because all of us, in our own strength, no miracles can happen in our own strength.
Right.
No power can happen in our own strength. It's all, no love, true love can't happen in our own strength. So really, anytime God uses us, he's using our weakness to reveal his strength.
Yeah.
Because it's just not natural.
Amen. So my next question comes from Shane on YouTube. And Shane asks, I was told that I know my identity well, but that I have ego issues. Do you think that might be one of those weaknesses that has been labeled, or one of those strengths that has been labeled as a weakness?
Well, without knowing you, I can only guess, but it's very possible. Some people think that confidence is arrogance. And so you might be like, man, I just love who I am in Christ, and I'm confident in my gifting and my strength. And just the fact that, you know, some people think that humility is always beating yourself up. And so if you ever say that you're good at something, they're like, you're arrogant, I can't believe you. When in reality, it's like, no, I'm just joyful. I'm so thrilled that I'm good at this. And actually, it annoys me that so many Christians are afraid to admit they're good at something.
Yeah.
Because they're so afraid of being called arrogant.
Mm-hmm.
Now, again, arrogance is a real thing that is a problem when people just walk, you know, just get conceited and cocky, just kind of, I'm better than you, or whatever that may, you know, however it may manifest. But being confident in who you are is not arrogance. Now, there's a balance, because just because you're very confident in who you are in Christ, if you go around being a know-it-all, then that is a problem, because it's like, well, I know who I am in Christ, but are you also choosing to serve people?
Mm-hmm.
Are you also choosing to be kind and respectful to people? But again, like you said, sometimes you could be the most humble person in the world. I mean, you see examples of this in the Word, where people are like, I know the wickedness of your heart, and people are accusing someone, and we know from Scripture they're a hero of the faith doing exactly what God called them to do, and people are like, I know that your heart is wicked, and it's wrong. They're wrong. Just because someone says something about you does not mean it's true. I've had people, like, I've taught on humility, and people go and say, hey, someone, I told them what you said, and they said that you're really arrogant for teaching that. And I know I'm not arrogant. I'm amazing. And so, again, sometimes people have the wrong interpretation of things. And they again, like I said, the black and white TV, they look at you and they see confidence and peace, and that you aren't self-deprecating and that you don't hate yourself and all that. And they say, wow, arrogance, because holiness is when you say, God, I'm a worm, I'm worthless. It's all you, not me. And if anybody compliments me, I have to say, no, it wasn't me. Don't compliment me. I'm just a donkey, and it's Jesus. It's okay to agree with God about what he says about you.
Amen.
Now, again, you want to have tact in how you express that to people. You don't want to go around just praising yourself all day long and be self-centered.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of people will accuse you of being arrogant if you're actually humble. And that's just because people misunderstand what true humility is and what true arrogance is.
Yeah, absolutely. Man, what a great teaching today, Daniel. Thank you for coming and taking the time.
Yeah, it's fun to see you guys again, by faith.
Amen. Awesome. Well, I just want to let you know as well, for those of you that had questions we didn't get to, check us out next Tuesday in the afternoon. We'll do our Tuesday roundup where we'll have hopefully one of your questions will get answered then as well. But thank you so much for joining with us, and you have a blessed week.
See you next time.
We are now enrolling for fall and spring semesters. Visit discovercaris.com or call 719-635-1111 to find out more about the Caris experience. Caris Bible College. Change your life. Change the world.
Join us every weekday for our daily live stream on Gospel Truth TV.